Hello, everybody. This is Tim again, here with my first Wes Craven review for Last House on the Left, baby. It's a Wes Craven classic. It's Wes Craven's first movie. It's actually produced by Sean Cunningham, who directed the first Friday the 13th, which is really cool. I don't think Sean Cunningham is actually a very good director myself, personally. I think he kind of lucked out with Friday the 13th, but that's a whole other story. But him and Wes Craven were friends, which is cool. And they finally got together and did Wes Craven did his first feature, Last House on the Left. Now, before this, Wes Craven had actually directed a few pornos, actually a few low-budget pornos, which many filmmakers did at the time back in the day in the early 70s and stuff like that to break into the genre of horror and stuff, and or just into the style, into filmmaking, you know, period. But anyway, just to get in the Last House on the Left, but I do find that funny, though, that Wes Craven started out doing pornos. I do get a laugh out of that. But yeah, Wes Craven, he's one of my favorite horror directors. I'm a huge fan of the guy. I like a whole lot of his, you know, oeuvre or whatever of his films. I enjoy most of his films. And this one, Last House on the Left, I like it. I don't love it, but I do like it. He did his first film, so I'm obviously going to cut him some slack on this. Most people's first films aren't anything, you know, mind-blowing. So the fact that his first film is even this as good as it is, you know, it's still much better than average. But anyway, just to jump into Last House on the Left. Last House on the Left is pretty much a standard story. It's a standard, you know, twist of fate revenge story, pretty much. You got these group of criminals. One of them, I actually think the woman of the group is actually played by Richard Dreyfuss's wife. Don't quote me on that. It's either his wife or his ex-wife. I'm not for sure. I know it's one of the two. She actually looks kind of hot, really, to me, in my opinion. 70s chicks are always kind of hot, in my opinion. But you got this. You got this group of criminals. The leader of the group, his name is Krug, I believe, which is short, pretty much short for Krueger. Or what will later become Krueger. They're all scumbags, rapists, scumbags, standard, you know, assholes of the week. But you got this girl, this daughter, who wants to go visit a friend, and so she goes to visit her friend, and so they go off to go buy some weed. So it's like, uh-oh, big no-no in horror movie. So they go off and buy some weed, coincidentally, off the son, who is addicted to drugs. Like, Krug, like, keeps him, or I believe it's Krug, is how you say it, keeps his own son addicted to drugs, so it'd be easier to control him and give him to do what he wants him to do. But anyway, and so he brings the two girls back to their hideout, which is, you know, stupid. But he brings them back. Brings them back there. Sorry. Something stuck in my throat. But yeah, he brings them back there. And, you know, of course, Krug walks in. Or Krug. I should just say Krug. I'm pretty sure it's Krug. But, yeah, he brings them back in. He comes in. And, of course, the gang, you know, beats the shit out of him. Takes him out. They pretty much stab one girl to death, you know. With a switchblade, and cut her hand off, and then the other girl is raped in a brutal scene. The rape is definitely not a nice thing to witness, but it does drive the point home that these are really sick bastards. One weakness wrong with this movie is that there's some bad musical choices in this movie. There's some really good musical choices, like The Road Leads to Nowhere. Any Wes Craven fan or fan of horror films that's seen this movie would tell you The Road Leads to Nowhere is a great song. Yeah, other than that, there's some really bad musical choices in this movie. Like when the killers are leaving their hideout and like taking the girls with them and throwing them in their trunk or whatever. And they're getting ready to drive off with them. Like when the killers are leaving their hideout, there's some music playing, and it makes the scene look like a scene from a Benny Hill video. If you've ever seen Benny Hill's videos, that's what it reminds me of. There's some really bad musical choices here. And even when the killers are like driving in their vehicle, there's like a friggin' it's almost like there's a really goofy ass song playing about actually about the killers. is like just singing about them and them like driving around or whatever. It's really stupid. It really doesn't mesh with what the movie's going for. The really hard 70s grungy style it's going for. And it's like playing this old, you know, folk music. It makes you want to go. It's like, what the fuck is this? The Twilight Zone? It's like, there's no mesh here. It's like doing a complete, you know, 180. But anyway. And you also got these two cops who keep looking for the kids, and they can't never find them. They're always like 1 second too late, every time they show up, there's this goofy music playing. They redo it in Halloween 5, the goofy music as a tribute to this movie, which is horrible in Halloween 5 as well. It's horrible here. But they should have been completely cut out of this movie. They serve no purpose whatsoever. Totally useless as characters. And they go and jump and get in a ride, and they get a ride. The two cops' car breaks down, right? And they jump and get a ride with this old lady who's missing, like, all her front teeth or whatever, and they jump in, like, where she's got like a bunch of chicken coops in the back of the vehicle, and she's like, hold on. On one hand, I'm like, what the fuck is this? You know, what is this? I mean, it doesn't even feel like the same movie. I feel like somebody switched this on me when I was young. You know, somebody put something different in here. But anyway, that's besides the point. But, the other girl gets raped. She just wanders off into the lake in a very, really sad shot scene. She just kind of wanders off into the lake. And then, one thing about the movie is it shows right here, like, where the camera focuses on the killers. They all have, like, looks on their faces of, like, how they felt like they went too far with these two girls or whatever. I've never understood that. I mean, I know it's supposed to show, you know, even the killers have a little bit of humanity in them, sparked in there somewhere. But these people have been so, so brutal that I just can't buy that they would give a shit about anything. I mean, honestly, I can't. They've been so brutal. I mean, they finally decide to show one glimpse of humanity on their faces for 2 seconds after they stab people to death and everything and then rape somebody. And they finally decide to show one glimpse of humanity. They just now realize they might have gone too far. I'm like, what? Fuck that. That's. I just can't buy that. But the girl wanders off into the lake, and then the leader, we'll say Krug. I'm pretty sure it's either Krug or Krug. I don't want to get into a 20-hour debate here about how you pronounce the guy's name. I know it's K-R-U-G. I'm gonna say Krug. And the girl wanders off into the lake. Krug shoots her with his pistol, you know, and like pretty much in the back of the head and kills her. So really sad. And of course, in a twist of fate, the killers wind up at the house of the victims. They wind up at the parents' house. You know, it's the last house on the left. Hence the title. So it's a twist of fate story. And yes, that's pretty unlikely that they would wind up there. But at the same time, you gotta buy into it. It's the whole point of the story. You know, you gotta be willing to go there. Otherwise, there's no movie. But yeah, I think it's kind of a neat idea. I like that idea of a twist of fate kind of thing going on there. But they wind up at the parents' house. The parents just coincidentally hear them talking about the fact that they killed their daughter. They just happen to hear them outside of the room they're staying in. It's just a coincidence. So I'm like, don't really buy that. I hate shit like that when somebody just happens to be walking by and they hear the information they want. I hate stuff like that in movies. But so they hear that. They go out into the woods. They just coincidentally happen to walk upon the daughter in no time, find her there dead. They just find her in like a few seconds, which is way too easy. So, you know, of course, like anybody, they want to say, you know, let's fuck them up. The parents' acting isn't too good. It's a little, I don't know what you'd call it, little 70s, well, almost all the actors in the movie, this is a 70s, like, low-budget movie, but almost everybody's acting in the movie kind of elevates from that. But these parents, the acting of the parents really, you know, stays down in that level. Their acting is the weakest. I mean, their acting's the weakest out of everybody. But, yeah, so they want to kill, you know, obviously these people. So the mom takes one guy out and ties his hands behind his back and bites his dick off, and so he bleeds to death. And when I see that, I'm like, okay, that seems a little bit thrown in there just for exploitation's sake. I can't really buy the woman, you know, biting the guy's dick off. That seems a little much. I can't buy a mom that would just bite a guy's dick off like that. That seems a little much. Seems more like she probably would have stabbed him to death or something when he went out there. I don't know. It just seems a little extreme, and just kind of put that in there to be on the, just to be extreme on the sexual side. But yeah, so he's dead. The other girl, she just kind of runs towards the mom, and the mom has the switchblade, and she just kind of runs towards her, and the mom runs towards her like this, just like running straight, but she's got her arms spread completely out. She just runs towards her and somehow like slits her throat. It's a really kind of shoddy done stunt or whatever in the movie, the way her throat gets slit, or the way she gets her throat slit. But she gets her throat slit, and then the girl like falls over into the pool though, which I liked, and she's like bleeding out, you know, through her neck in the pool. I like that shot. But yeah, she pretty much goes like that. Oh, and another thing, the parents like rig the house full of booby traps. So when the last guy is like running around the house, he's slipping on shaving cream and stuff, and he's like grabbing, you know, doorknobs and getting electroshocked. I thought that was way too silly. as like Home Alone, it's hard for me to take the movie entirely seriously with that kind of stuff going on. But I mean, especially in the movie that's trying to be so serious. But yeah, the last guy, Krug is pretty much getting in a fight with the dad. He's beating the dad up, of course, because he's much younger than the dad, and the dad's much older. But yeah, he's beating the dad up, but the dad manages to get a chainsaw, and, you know, it's like, I'm going to fuck you up. And so this is the main guy, the main, you know, piece of shit on the chopping block here. And so the dad's got the chainsaw, and he's coming towards him, and then the cops just randomly happen to show up at this time. Okay. Like I said, completely cut out of the movie. They need to be cut out of this movie. But the cops just randomly show up. Okay. But yeah, I'm like, eh, well, I'm kind of enjoying the movie so far. And then, the dad's got Krug down. And, you know, he's going to chainsaw his ass. And so pretty much he just leans down the chainsaw him, and then the camera just cuts away. You don't see any impact. You don't see him, you know, actually hit him. It just cuts away. Like as soon as the dad's like leaning down, the camera just cuts away. It skips to the next scene, and you know, dad's just there with a chainsaw. And, you know, Krug's dead. I mean, that's pretty much it. That's his death. And I'm like, that's lame. I know it's at the time, yeah, when they couldn't have really done a big chainsaw death. But at the same time, I'm thinking, well, if you can't do it, why are you using it? I mean, at the time is not an excuse. I mean, you work with what you got. If it doesn't work, it's not satisfying, don't do it. but yeah, it's not a very impactful death for the main killer, especially since it's a cutaway. It doesn't really work. But yeah, a weak death for the main killer. So yeah, all in all, I have to say, this is a decent movie. I'd give it 2.5 stars out of a possible 4. I would say this is a decent movie. I like the movie, but the movie is limited to the budget and the time it was made. They couldn't really go all out in the death of the main guy at the end, the main killer. So and some of the musical choices are really bad. And also the cops are terrible and have no reason to be in this movie. But yeah, not a bad movie at all, and a decent movie. In my opinion, this is a decent horror film. Fun little twist of fate. I mean, well, I wouldn't say really fun, but a decent little twist of fate horror movie. Definitely one to check out, especially if you are a Wes Craven fan. You want to check out his old school work, definitely go for this one. I do find the film entertaining, except for the stupid humor. But yeah, a decent movie. One to definitely check out. Yeah, I recommend this movie. It's decent. I do think the remake's better. The remake is better. The remake serves from being more serious and cutting out the stupid humor. Although the remake does have a stupid ending with a microwave, but I'll get into that sometime in the future. But yeah, all in all, for this movie, it's a decent movie. Definitely recommend it. And so I'll see you guys again with the next Wes Craven review.